So now my struggle, my fight, the purpose of this hunger strike is I need the bank to have my record restored, both internally and externally. Mind you, if you are an HR person and I'm coming to an interview and I'm claiming to have managed this global project and I'm claiming to have laid this study that had resulted into the publication of this book and the publication of this reports that is considered to be a significant contribution to the field. And you look at the World Bank website and it says that I was never a manager, I've never laid anything.
Mm-hmm.
And on top of that, you're reading that I cannot work with people and the international community do not want to work with me. And this is a very difficult person to work with. Who in his right mind would agree to give you a position? Any position, leave alone a significant level management position. So that needs to be restored, and my identity, my professional identity, which is pretty much based on my professional credentials and my experience and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But the bank is saying, no, we will not do that. Because even though technically we have restored his record, substantively we do not stand behind the contents of this evaluation,
mm-hmm.
his record. So that is a problem, but there is a way out. And that way out is the US government has passed a new law, or now it's an old law, in 2012, requiring the World Bank to grant staff access to external arbitration.
Mm-hmm.
To resolve any kind of staff disputes.
Mm-hmm.
And the law says unequivocally, explicitly, that if the bank fails to comply with this law,
mm-hmm.
the US government would stop any kind of financial support to the bank until such time that the bank proves either to the US Department of State or to the US Treasury that the bank is actually implementing this new procedure to agree to go to external arbitration
mm-hmm.
to settle employment disputes. The US government to date has refused to enforce it. And since the bank also understands that the US is not serious about enforcing that law, they have absolutely no incentive to honor and respect my credentials, my professional identity. And you know, you can imagine that you have done, let's say, a master's or a PhD or law
mm-hmm.
degree from your university, and 20 years later you go back to them and you say, I want you to send my credentials, my record, to such and such university, I want to pursue an additional study, or send it to such and such employer because I want them to see what I have achieved or accomplished in terms
mm-hmm.
of education.
Mm-hmm.
And the school telling you that, oh, we're sorry, all this A's you had received in 1992 or 1995 or 2002, they are too good to be true for someone like you. And therefore, we cannot send your grades to any institution
mm-hmm.
or to a third party.
Mm-hmm.
We will keep it in your file. We're okay as long as mm-hmm. it's kept in a confidential file.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, what the bank is doing is this. Yes, we have your true record and your confidential HR files, but no, we are not going to honor it or honor its content as true performance. Because, see, this notion of it is too good to be true is not a notion or a concept that they could even think of using to a Caucasian or to an Asian. The bank has several studies. These are confidential studies, but reports which we have copies of. In 1998, there was a study that the bank surveyed a number of managers and asked them, why is this that you do not hire an African as a professional? Why is this that you do not hire an African in your department, and so on? And many of them responded saying that Africans, sub-Saharan Africans in particular, sub-Saharan Africans are intellectually inferior. And this is an official survey. It's not, you know, corridor talk or something that, you know, friends talk over coffee. This is an official survey result. In 2013, the first one, 1998, was done by World Bank experts, assigned by then President James Wolfensohn. But in 2013, they wanted to see what the result would be if it was done by outside experts, experts that are trained to do this kind of analysis. They came back with the same conclusion that there is this pervasive culture, endemic culture of racism that regards sub-Saharan Africans in particular, I'm quoting, not smart or not bright and not competent to be in management. And some of their comments are, some of the regions do not want to work with Africans, and the Africans would be better off to work within the Africa region. That way they would compete with each other. So there is this notion of Africans cannot perform at a high level. So when they say your record is too good to be true, in reality, what they're saying is this record is too good to be true for a black person. Because there is no concept of saying, oh, Mr. Jack, a Caucasian, his record is too good to be true. No, if Jack is a Caucasian or an Asian, and if his record is too good to be true, there is a reason for fast-track promotion. Because the bank wants us to get as much as possible capable people. So it's a matter of the color was the primary issue.
Let me take you back again on that deleting employee record. Is this a common practice at the World Bank? Did this happen to anybody else, or was it the first one to happen?
There were two cases, but in a completely different way. But this is the first ever, as far as I know, for the World Bank to go back 8 years and say those 8 years of record are too good to be true. And what makes it bizarre is it is the very director that had signed those 8 years that is now saying, or was saying, that his record is over-exaggerated, too good to be true, hagiographic. So it has never been done to deny someone promotion. Because most of the time, when they deny you promotion, they try to come up with a reason. Technically, he is sound. Managerially, he is sound, but you know, he is not a people's person. Or they cannot come up with anything because both my managerial performance as well as my, you know, they have again, performance evaluation on partnership building, teamwork,
right,
and ability to associate with others, understanding other cultures and so on. All those for 8 years were marked either as outstanding or as superior. So with all those results showing much higher than the average performance in the bank, even at the management level, That has never been done. When a well-qualified person is told, we will not use your record in our decision-making for promotion or for this new job you're applying for, because your record is null and void, because it's too good to be true. It has never happened before. I'm not the only one saying this. The bank's senior advisor for racial equality, who's been with the bank for 30 years, and most of which he was involved in HR, and most of which he was diversity and inclusion manager. But at one point he was the bank's senior advisor for racial equality, and he was reporting to the president. He said, in my 30 years experience in the bank, I have never seen this kind of injustice. He says it's profoundly beyond the pale. He is not the only one, and the Staff Association has said this case shows, I'm quoting, several aspects of the bank's internal justice system is broken. And quite a number of my former supervisor, from whom I took the position.
Okay.
Yes. He wrote that what the bank is saying is an outright lie. He used the term lie. He said, I'm sorry to use this term, but to use any other term would mitigate or minimize the seriousness of this crime, because the crime was administered under oath, under the oath of law, as he put it. And other people also said, we have never seen this kind of blatant injustice. So it's never been done before.
Do you think this deleting records got involved many people, or just can't be done by one person?
No.
How the system works?
Yeah, no.
There must be a mechanism there to stop all these kind of things.
It's when you look at the extent that the bank had gone to delete my record, one involves the HR vice president, because my managers, even my vice president, my senior vice president, could not go into my files to delete them. They have no access. So it's the HR vice president or someone working in the HR at a fairly high level to be able to go in and delete my record. So at least now you have two different departments involved, or vice presidents actually. They have also gone and deleted my record from the internet, from published materials. This also requires someone outside of our department to agree. So this the whole decision is an institutional decision. The bank's general counsel, a senior vice president for the legal complex, she was well aware of the fact that my record was deleted, because when she was presenting the deleted or the falsified version, I was submitting my copies of the true. So she knew what was going on. So at the very least, three different vice presidencies were either directly involved or were fully aware of what
what's
was
going
done.
On.
Yeah. So it's an institutional thing, because the bank is afraid that if one African, one black person is allowed to prevail on a racial discrimination case, that opens up this the proverbial lawsuit or floodgate, the proverbial, you know, lawsuit floodgate, and that is what they're trying to protect. At any cost, this case must be suppressed. If he wins and if he prevails, there are hundreds of Africans. You know, there was one study in 2005, I believe, The senior advisor for racial equality reported that his office alone, there are different offices that are dealing with racial discrimination. His office alone has received 450 cases of racial discrimination in a span of 5 years. If you exclude bank holidays, there are many, this amount is to roughly about two per week, year round. And yet, not a single black person had prevailed. That is one issue that the bank was protecting. The second issue, and that is also another factor, is the vice presidency that I was a part of is called the Development Economics Vice President. That is the bank's ivory tower. That is where the bank calls it ivory tower. That's where the bank's policies are drawn, strategies are prepared, and all the studies are done. And black people are completely or virtually shut out of that vice presidency. Out of 170 to 180, I've been in that unit for nearly all my 17 years. Sometimes we were two, sometimes we were three. At most, at one point, we were four. And the fourth guy left back, a very, very qualified African, trained at Oxford, PhD, has taught at major universities and so on. And he said, Yonas, how did you survive in this place, in this vice presidency for this long? He looked for a job in different part of the bank and left. So because the bank, particularly that vice presidency, has been blamed for being racist, the bastion of racism, mm-hmm. and excluding Africans, mm-hmm. and they have been always saying, no, you know, this is a very highly competitive the vice presidency. If we find qualified people, we would hire them. And then here you have, by the bank's own peer review, you know, I'm quoting, talented, tenured, well qualified, and they did what they did. So if I were to prevail, then that is another evidence that the reason why black people are virtually absent from that vice presidency is because of racism. So both at the bank level, at the macro level, at the, you know, another level, at the vice presidency level, this is going to be a blow to their credibility. So they have to suppress it. What is very difficult to understand is this. In 2010, they had an opportunity. In 2009, they had an opportunity. When the peer review committee told them, this is unfair, this is, we didn't want to judge for him because we did not want to create a precedent and, you know, damage the credibility of the bank, but we strongly recommend, and I'm quoting, strongly recommend that the bank engage with Mr. Biru in a binding mediation. They could have mediated at that point, but no, they didn't want to because they do not like to be challenged on race. Even, you know, getting to that level, to a mediation, that was one. And the second one was, the U.S. government came in and told them, or asked them, this is a serious issue. Why do not you resolve it through mediations, arbitration, or some kind of settlement? Mm-hmm. Let him go his way. Let him, you go your way. He is not too keen to come back to the bank, but do the right thing, compensate him properly for what you've done, and straighten up his record, both inside and outside. Don't drag this thing. And they said no. And once in 2014, when they finally agreed to restore my file internally, mm-hmm. that was yet another window of opportunity for them to say, okay, now since we have two different stories, let's go to the tribunal, explain, you know, the people who have done this have retired.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed they have. So we want to do the right thing. We want to withdraw, and we will settle with him. That was yet another opportunity there.
Mm-hmm.
But they dug deep, and they stayed firm, and they say, no, you know, we do not respond to the U.S. government. We do not respond to the U.S. Senate. We do not respond to 500 church leaders. You know, we are above and beyond law.
Why the U.S.? Now, you mentioned it earlier, the U.S. government is not interested to enforce the law. Why do you think that?
There are two issues.
Mm-hmm.
And the first one is the U.S. government has great influence over the World Bank. What the U.S. does not tolerate will not happen in the World Bank. They are the largest shareholder.
Mm-hmm.
They are the largest fund providers. They are the host institution.
Mm-hmm.
They always appoint the president. So their president, this is an Obama appointee. Someone from Obama's administration can call him and simply say, look, this is not only you, it reflects badly on us. He would do it at a heartbeat. But the bank uses, the US government uses the bank when they need it for strategic reasons. If they don't want to provide funding for country X, or you want to provide more funding for country Y, you know, the bank has its influence, the US government has its influence to do that. That is one factor. So this was not for them strategic enough. And the other is, as a matter of strategy, and long-standing strategy at that, the World Bank does not hire African Americans. In 2009, out of 1,100 plus, American professionals, African Americans were four.
It's not even one person there.
Four out of 1,100 plus. The bank understands that if there were 400, you know, there are 2,500 Africans and Caribbeans.
Mm-hmm.
If out of those 2,500 or 400, if there were 400 African Americans, they would burn that place down if they were to do this kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
They would not take it like most Africans would. That's one factor. The bank also understands that if they did half of what they are doing to the Africans, if they were to do it to African Americans, the U.S. government would have to step in. So the fact that I am an Ethiopian, not an African American, is another factor why the Obama administration
didn't want to do that much.
Is not exactly. In the past, the bank had settled cases with African Americans, and they know what implications it would have. The Congressional Black Caucus would have a firmer position than they had in my case. There is a number of factors. An African American or African American lawmakers would sympathize and empathize more with an African American. They have, you know, this experience from slavery to Jim Crow to all kind of civil rights issues. It just resonates with them when an African American is maltreated or mistreated. For an African, yes, they may feel and see, but it's a degree is completely different. So that could be another factor. And the third one is the current president, Jim Yong Kim, Korean American. It's, as I said earlier, very good friend of Obama, President Obama, and Secretary Clinton, as well as President Clinton. He's a very powerful person within the democratic establishment.
Mm-hmm.
So he has an influence in terms of calling very higher
chambers, Congress.
Yeah. Yes, at much higher level political figures. And those people would call down the line and say, look, step back. You know, this guy is doing this. And one person's case should not be a reason for the U.S. to take issue with the African, with the World Bank. This is why the strategy or my purpose of going on this hunger strike is not expecting that I would get a result from the World Bank. World Bank would not care. But if there is a public pressure and if there is exposure, it is the American government, the Obama administration, that would have to answer why is this that having determined, having members of the U.S. Senate determined, having members of the U.S. Congress, Congressional Black Caucus determined, and having the U.S. Treasury determined that this case is unjust and should be resolved by external arbitration. They have put this in writing. And considering the fact that there is already, there are actually two U.S. laws in the books requiring the bank to resolve this cases like mine, through external arbitration or lose funding. Why isn't the bank enforcing that? Is this because, you know, most of the people who are currently suffering are Africans and the Obama administration is not seeing, you know, this is an issue of African lives matter, beyond Black Lives Matter, or African rights matter. So this kind of public pressure that perhaps the hunger strike could create. We have created some we have created some attention.
Mm-hmm.
We discussed earlier Ambassador Andrew Yang having read my son's article on the Huffington Post.
Okay.
Wants to be involved. I was really taken when I received his call out of nowhere.
Okay.
Called me a couple of days ago. He said, this is Andrew Yang. And I was seriously considering to join you in your hunger strike because I have never seen one case like this. And there are others that in the making that are trying to get the U.S. government to act. So that is where, if anything, a solution can come from.
Do you think this organization or this entity, in this case World Bank, is above the law?
It is above the law. I mean, by law, it is above the law. Mm-hmm. The U.S. government has given it full immunity. But that full immunity comes with a condition, and that is you will have a functioning justice system within the institution that should be independent and fair in its judgment. But for 40 years, the tribunal has been anything but. So even by the law, by that granted them this immunity, accorded them this immunity, this immunity should be challenged because in 1999, the U.S. government commissioned a study, its own study, It was conducted by the U.S. By the Government Accountability Office,
okay.
GAO. And they concluded that the tribunal is neither independent nor fair. And because of that, the majority of victims of discrimination do not even bother to report in 1999. And they recommended the bank should try external arbitration. There are two World Bank studies that concluded to the same thing. There is a Government Accountability Project, which is an outside entity, an NGO, a group of high-level lawyers. They did an extensive study and concluded that the tribunal has a double standard. Black people do not get justice before the tribunal. Others, actually, even when it comes to discrimination, racial discrimination, other races stand a better chance of winning some level of compensation. Mm-hmm. But for blacks, it's 100% rejection. The Civil Rights Coalition that was led by Jesse Jackson and NAACP, Urban League, and so on, they did, their own lawyers did a study, and as part of, you know, reviewing my case, one of their conclusion is the tribunal is unfit. Actually, it's an extension of the bank's legal team. It suppresses evidence. It allows the bank to use false evidence. It violates its own rules and articles, the tribunal's own rules and articles. And it is unfit to adjudicate any kind of racial discrimination cases. So there is no reason for this tribunal to continue to see cases. And the US government has the power. Since 1992, it has the legal tools because of the new laws that requires them to withdraw funding from the World Bank. So, but that could only come through public pressure, and I'm hopeful that we, if anything comes out of this, it would come from the U.S. government forcing the bank, threatening the bank, encouraging the bank that we will be forced to enforce the law unless the World Bank comes to terms with this case and other similar cases. Mm-hmm.
So now if they reinstate your external record, will you quit the hunger strike that you started? What was your exact demand?
Okay,
right,
my demand is, well, you could say I have two demands.
Okay.
The first one is restore my record externally. Mm-hmm. Take out all the false narratives that you've created that are completely orthogonal, completely and starkly different from my record. And what that requires is part of this false record has become part of the tribunal's judgment. The bank gave the tribunal false evidence. The tribunal used that false evidence. So for the bank, part of it they can withdraw themselves because it's on their website. Mm-hmm. But part of it they have to ask the tribunal, the evidence we gave you is false, now we have reinstated it in his record, we take responsibility, please take it out. That is the first demand. The second demand is, of course, once you agree that you had used false evidence to deny me justice, to derail the course of justice, that would mean the dismissal of my racial discrimination case in 2010 was unjust, and therefore it would have to be reopened. So that would create an environment where that they can settle the damage I had sustained, that's emotional, psychological, financial, and career setback that I had endured. If this is what they can do, but there is also an easier way of dealing with this, and that is, okay, Jonas, this is going to require going to the tribunal. The tribunal being independent, at least in name, may say that you can do whatever you want to do with him. Our decision that was based on what we had and what we have seen will remain standing. Therefore, we are not going to withdraw the evidence we have received, even if now we learn that it was false. So there is nothing that forces the tribunal to withdraw or reverse their judgment. And more than likely that they're likely to say that. So the bank has a number of options, and an option of last resort could have been to say, no, we cannot change what is outside, because that would involve the administrative tribunal. But we can find a solution. Why don't we settle this case? We will compensate you for the damage that having this record outside would cause you. We understand with that kind of false information, your career would be derailed. Your income generating ability would be affected. So let's sit down and negotiate what are the terms that we can agree on in terms of financial arrangement, in terms of separation, and so on. The bank, money is not an issue for the bank. But as an individual, the settlement not only vindicates you, you will never be whole again. What has been taken away from you cannot be restored fully. But it can be mitigated. They could do certain things to A, acknowledge that yes, you know, what was done to you is wrong. That is a long way from where we are. Then the second thing is really our actions have caused you damage in different ways. Mm-hmm. Emotional damage, psychological suffering, and financial setback, and career derailment. So for that, we would, you know, pay you X or pay you Y, and you settle that. You know, we part ways, and the bank could still maintain whatever, you know, false information they have on the record. For me, what is important is the false record that is outside has consequences on my career, on my income generating abilities. And also that is injustice, but for them to come and to settle the matter will address the injustice because it's an acknowledgement on their part to say, okay, we'll pay for it, is we have damaged you. So that is the absolute minimum that they could do. But they are not prepared to do, or they will not do, unless otherwise cornered, pressured, and unless otherwise they feel that it damages the bank's credibility. And also, it can have some consequences. Imagine Donald Sterling, the former owner of Clippers. Mm-hmm. All he did was he uttered or rant racial slur in a private telephone conversation, which is within his constitutional right. You can say whatever you want to say, right or wrong. So he did not break any law as far as the law is concerned. Yes, what he said is immoral, what he said is unethical, what he said is offensive. But he paid consequences for that. And that was including losing his team and being banned from the game of basketball for life, even though he did not break any law. Compare that with what the bank has done. That committing crime, falsifying someone's record, and disenfranchising a person of his income earning ability, disenfranchising someone of his professional identity is a crime. And to say that someone's record is too good to be true has a connotation of saying a black person cannot perform at that level. And not only have they harbored that, but they have also acted on it. And in so doing, have taken away somebody else's right. So what Donald Sterling did pales in comparison to what the current World Bank president is doing. But he faces no consequence. Yes, legally he cannot face consequences, any consequence because of the immunity. But there should be political consequence. His term came to end, his term is ending in 2017. You know, one consequence could have been for the Obama administration to kick him out and put somebody else. No, they are renewing his contract for another 5-year term or his term. So there is no consequence for these people, not financially, not legally, not politically. So it is that I am fighting to expose. And that's why I say the solution can only come from the US government, because they have a law that they need to enforce. So basically, that wraps up, you know.
So after all this, if they wanted to take you back, the World Bank, will you be back there and work again?
No, like, there is absolutely no scenario, no condition that I would go back to the World Bank. It would not be right for me. Mm-hmm. It would not even be right for the bank itself as an institution, because this case has gone too far and too wide. There is no international organization that did not know about this case. They have all written a support letter for me. A couple of them have written a support letter to the bank, primarily European Union and the OECD. What, by the way, is very interesting was the chief statistician for OECD wanted to be a witness for the bank. Mm-hmm. And he wrote his testimony under oath. And before he submitted it, his lawyers included a cover letter. And that cover letter says, we are submitting this statement with the understanding that we are immune from lawsuit. He knew what he was writing was wrong. He knew what he was writing was false. But in the meantime, yes, I can do that because I have no consequences, because I am protected by law that I would not face. So, you know, it had involved the OECD, the European Union. It has involved all regional banks in Asia, Africa, Latin America, all regional UN agencies. They were either my witness or at least two Europeans were banks' witness. So it has gone way too far to salvage that relationship. And I would not feel comfortable going back. Mm-hmm. I would not see myself growing. Now the bank has increased the retirement age to 67. Okay. So I would have some 8 to 9 years to do before retirement. But I would not see myself going back. I want a resolve. I want proper compensation for the damage, and I want to part ways with the institution.
Okay, Dr. Yonas, thank you so much for your time and for this interview, and thank you again for having us over here too. And at the end, before we wrap up our interview, I want to give a chance if you want to add something to the world, and if you want to say something, please go ahead.
Yeah, I'd like to reiterate my first statement. Thank you so much for coming here. It took a lot to bring your equipment and your time. It's much appreciated, truly, and I'm grateful for that. The only thing I would say, we have discussed at length my story, that it's an appeal to your viewers that we do need to speak when we see injustice. So in whatever way that they could spread this, whether it is access they may have with media, you know, there are many Ethiopian bloggers, so there are many Ethiopians involved in TV and mainstream media, to bring this issue to light. And most importantly also, to go to my website, longerthanapartheid.com, and sign a petition and ask friends and relatives to sign a petition. Oftentimes, this is not only with our compatriots, but oftentimes people kind of think, oh God, this story is outrageous. But, you know, a whole lot of people will sign it. And then, you know, not take that extra 1 minute to click a few buttons and to sign the petition. Some people may have concerned that their names or their emails would appear, but the email never appears in on the website. Their name, they can decide not their names to be shown. At the bottom of the petition, there is a small box that you can tick. You could say that what that means is your name will not show, your email would not show, or your story will not show. Only your vote would count.
Yeah.
So I do hope that they will take that extra step and go and sign the petition. The petition has a very, very important role, because I have been told by former friends at the World Bank that the bank is closely monitoring how far this petition is going, how far this hunger strike is going. So the more people sign, it creates pressure not only on the bank, but also on the US government. So with that last appeal or final appeal, I thank your viewers, and thank you again. It was a great opportunity.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Yonas. Thank you. Thanks for watching this program. If you wanted to support and sign a petition, please, as you see it on our screen, go to www.longerthanapartheid.com and support Dr. Yonas Biru. Thanks for watching.